Hi there. My name is Miles Turk, and I'm from Augsburg College, and today I'm here to tell you about an interesting lab that we had just performed in my chemistry lab. I'm going to start off by telling you and showing you something pretty interesting about scorpions, a unique quality that they possess. Right there, shut the lights off. All right. Okay, as you can see, the scorpion is fluorescing green. It's a green glow. And when a scorpion is hit with UV radiation or light, it causes the scorpion to glow a fluorescent green, a greenish glow. And it's just strange. So what could cause this? Well, scorpions are believed to have two compounds in their cuticles that cause them to fluoresce. Why they contain these compounds is still kind of unknown, like what their use was or is for, if it still is in use, or if it's just a dormant characteristics that they have yet to weed out through evolution. And one of the components is believed to be methylalumbrinferone, which is what we're synthesizing today in the reaction. Alright, so in this reaction, which is the synthesis of 4-methylalumbrinferone, two reagents are used, which is ricinol and ethyl acetate, and these will form our product. And instead of calling it that, I'm just going to call it clumens, because that's a group that this molecule that is formed falls into, and it'll be more logical to explain calling it this. And this reaction requires an acid catalyst, but instead of using a liquid catalyst that we would have to work up, we're going to be using a solid catalyst, which is called Amberlis 15. Okay. So why do this reaction? Why try to create a compound that only occurs in a scorpion in nature? Well, the fact that it's only found in nature. If we can make this compound that is found in nature, we can use it. And that goes for more than just this compound. It goes for any compound that we find in nature that we don't already have in a lab. If we can make it, we can find a use for it. And that's how we advance in science. And green chemistry is also used in this lab, which is a great way to not only save money, but save materials too. And I'll explain more of that later. Alright, so one of the techniques that we'll be using to identify our compound to make sure that we created the correct compound is IR spectroscopy, or infrared spectroscopy. And I'm sure all of you know what that is, but I'm just going to give a quick review. Alright, so the molecule is hit with infrared radiation, and this causes the bonds inside within the molecule to shake and vibrate and move around. And as they shake and vibrate, they all vibrate at the different functional groups in the molecule will vibrate at different frequencies. And then those frequencies are read by the spectrum, and a graph is produced. And so it shows us what functional groups lie in which molecule, and then this in turn will tell us if which molecule we have by looking at the different functional groups of the structure that we know. All right, so what I did for this reaction was I placed 3 grams of Amberlis 15, the acid catalyst, 1 milliliter of ethyl acetate, and 800 milligrams of ricinol, and I placed them in an Erlenmeyer flask, 50 milliliters. And I already had a boiling thing of water on the hot plate, and so I placed my Erlenmeyer flask in the boiling water, and I let it sit for, well, not just sit, I let it heat up for an hour, occasionally stirring. And I knew the reaction was complete after the hour because the bubbles had ceased and the liquid had darkened and almost hardened on the bottom of my flask. So then, once this had occurred, I added 2 milliliters of boiling ethanol to the mixture, and this will dissolve my product. And then, so I took that mixture and I put it into a new clean Erlenmeyer flask. This was to weed out the Amberlis 15. And then I redid the same wash with the boiling ethanol, just to make sure all my product was dissolved. Once I had mixed it with the ethanol, I placed that on the hot plate and let that reach a boil. Once it reached a boil, I turned the hot plate off and started adding water drop-wise. The reason I did this was to help bring my product out of solution. So you add it drop-wise until it turns cloudy. Never adding more than 2 milliliters because that'll kind of make it oily. And then so I took it off the hot plate and let it cool to room temperature. And then from there, once it cooled to room temperature, I placed it in an ice bath until it was cold and it had crystallized and our solid was formed. And then to get our solid out, I used vacuum filtration to remove all the excess other components and just leaving us with our solid. And then I ran our IR test on this solid in order to determine if I did create the correct solid. And so, as you can see, this is my IR data. And I'll start off with this big wide peak down here. And what that tells me right away is that there's an OH group in whatever I've created. And if you look at the structure of the cumarin, yep, you see there's the OH group right here also. All right, so this next peak we have is at right around 1600, which is key that we have a benzene ring. As you can see in our structure, we do indeed have a benzene ring. And then this next peak that we have, which is about right around, let's say like 1500 to 1400. And this is ether. As we can see, we do indeed have an ether. And so this is leading me to believe that we do indeed have our compound. And I know there's a lot of other peaks down here with numbers, and you're wondering, oh, well, why aren't you looking at those? Because a lot of times it picks up different readings that aren't as important as the major functional groups within the molecule. All right, so I found that cumarin was indeed produced, and the IR proved this. And in order to be completely sure that it indeed fluoresces is a compound that is in the scorpion, I placed it under the IR, and it indeed fluoresced just about the same color as a scorpion did, as I showed you earlier. All right, so now I'm going to talk about the green chemistry that we use in this reaction. So the first way we use green chemistry is using the solid catalyst. The reason this is green chemistry is a couple reasons. The first being that we didn't have to do a workup for our acid, which means we're using less chemicals. And because it's a solid, we can filter it out and then reuse it. So it allows us to reuse the solid over and over, and which in turn will save us money. And also, we didn't use any solvent in this reaction, which you can, but we didn't for this reaction. So therefore, we're using less material, saving us money yet again. All right, and in conclusion, being able to synthesize a product that is found only in nature expands our ability to make the use of these different compounds. And using green chemistry techniques will be more cost efficient and save you money in the long run. Thank you, and I'll open it up for questions.